Well, good afternoon, everyone, and welcome. Welcome to Bristol Community College for our community members and for our colleagues in learning in the BCC family. Thank you so much for coming. My name is Jack Sprague. It's my honor and privilege to serve as president of this great institution. And we have wonderful events such as this to which you're all invited. And I thank you very much for coming. Dr. Weisberger has done quite a bit of work in setting up the Holocaust Center. I should give a shout out also to Dr. Howard Tinberg, who has helped him as well. They have an honors course on the Holocaust. And it's really picked up a great deal of interest throughout the community and the region. So this is another example of the good work that they're doing. So I thank Dr. Weisberger especially for organizing this, and you're going to hear more about other Holocaust Center events from Dr. Weisberger. But I'm very excited. I want to get out of here so we can hear from our featured speaker. And let me now introduce to you Dr. Ron Weisberger.
Thank you, Dr. Sprager. The college has always been wonderful in supporting the work of our Holocaust Center. We really appreciate it. We have a we do have a kind of an office with a little library, which people are welcome to come. 200A, second floor of the library, and we have some books that people can borrow. So I say the college, and take advantage of that. We do have some other, March 30th, we have a one-woman play. Susan Stein, an actress from New York, is going to do a play about a woman who died in Auschwitz but left a diary, and it's based on her diary. So that's March 30th, a Wednesday at 2 o'clock, and you'll probably hear more about that. April 15th, we have an all-day conference on Friday on the Cambodian genocide. So these are all open to the community. So again, take advantage of it if you're able to. I wanted to just very quickly thank, as usual, as always, the Jewish Federation of New Bedford Holocaust Center Association, whatever we are. Cindy Yoakum is the chair, Marsha Onovac, and Maria, right? We're all members of the committee, but this Holocaust Center emerged out of the work of the Federation, and the Jewish Federation of New Bedford helps to fund us, as well as others. We're always open for donations, in case anybody wants to donate, but we're very fortunate to get support from the Jewish Federation and other folks as well. So that allows us to bring in speakers and do the different programs that we're doing. And speaking of that, this is what you're here for today, right? Quickly think too, we have, you heard Dr. Sprague talk about Dr. Howard Tinberg, who's here somewhere. He and I, there he is, he and I teach the Holocaust courses, our 13th year, our class is here. And just to remind our class that after this, we'll go back to our classroom and our speaker is willing to come and meet with our class. So please proceed, follow Dr. Tinberg as we go to our building. I also want to mention too that please no flash while the speaker is speaking, it's distracting, and please, of course, shut off your phones and all the rest. I want to thank Carrie, who's over here. She came with Louise and has done a wonderful job telling me exactly what I can do and what I can't do. This is sponsored, and that reminds me. This is sponsored in part by the U.S. Holocaust Memorial Museum, and we are very pleased to be able to bring Louise Lawrence-Israels here for us. The both Dr. Tinberg and I have now been doing a fellowship with the museum, so we have a close relationship with them now, and we're actually going to be doing a conference in the fall sponsored by the U.S. Holocaust Museum. It's a wonderful enterprise, and you can go online, and the resources are just amazing. And hopefully some of you get to go to it in D.C. It's just an amazing place. And one of the things they do is they have speakers. So we are very, again, fortunate to have Louise Lawrence-Israels here to speak to us. And her story is amazingly compelling. She spoke this morning at Conley High School to the whole school, and students were entranced, and I know you will be as well. So let me introduce Louise.
Good afternoon, and it's my pleasure to be here with you. It's a really an honor for me to talk to you. And you heard that my name was or is Louise Lawrence-Israels. I was born Louise Israels. Lawrence is my husband's name. Since I'm from the Netherlands, I keep the custom and have the whole long name. But I had no idea what my name was till I was about 3 years old. I was Maria, family name, that something like that exists. I had no idea. And that was all to keep us safe. My story is very much my parents' story, and I want to tell you how exceptional my parents were. They were very unselfish. When the Nazis invaded Holland in May 1940, it was a big shock. My little brother, who's my big brother actually, was just born, and my parents were very worried about him. Especially him, no, about nobody else, not about themselves, not about anybody else, just about my brother. And then 18 months later, I was born. So everything they did was to keep their children safe as possible. A little bit of background, my parents were Jewish, so I'm Jewish, but they weren't very religious. Our family, I should say family branch, had lived in Holland for more than 500 years, and through the years people became less and less religious and very integrated into Dutch life. Well, it didn't make any difference when the Nazis invaded. A Jew is a Jew was for them. So in 1939, when Germany invaded Poland, the Dutch government got scared. They had never thought that Germany would do something against Holland. Holland and Germany were friends. Holland had managed to stay out of the First World War, had been neutral, and who would do something bad to France? But then after the Nazis invaded Poland, Holland got scared and started mobilizing all people, all men above the age of 18. My father was a reserve officer and was mobilized and stationed in the southern part of Holland. You can see on the screen a map of Holland. It's actually a map of the Benelux. It's the Netherlands, Belgium, and Luxembourg. So Holland, Netherlands is on the top. You see a bright, dark line at the end, at the bottom, at the southern part of Holland, and then you get Belgium, and then you go a little bit more to the east, and you see a very small country, that's Luxembourg. So my father was actually stationed right outside Maastricht, what is the most southern town in Holland. And you can see it if you look to the southern border of Holland, and you kind of see that there's a little peninsula going into Belgium. He was stationed by one of the big rivers, the Meuse River, and his battalion was supposed to prevent the German army from coming into Holland. But the army was not an unbelievably organized body. They had uniforms that from before the First World War that were so boiled wool that my father said he couldn't even move his arms. The arms that they had and the weapons were so old, but they tried to do their best. But when the Nazis invaded Holland, and my father's battalion blew up the bridges over the Meuse River to try to prevent them from coming in. They had the rubber boats ready, and they came in anyway through Germany, because Germany is to the east of Holland. You can see that on the map. And then France is to the south of Belgium. And that whole blue area is the Atlantic Ocean. The story is that one of the reasons that the Germans wanted to take over the Netherlands, or Holland, as I like to say, because Netherlands to me is a tongue twister. They really wanted to conquer the whole world. At that time, in the 40s or late 30s, if you wanted to do that, you needed good harbors for large ships. And Germany only had a border with a waterway in the north, and it wasn't big enough. So they wanted our harbor town of Rotterdam. So they came into Holland. They took that whole area, all the people that were stationed by the river, as prisoners of war. So it was my father was a prisoner of war. And then the Dutch army fought for 4 days and capitulated because they had lost so many people that it wasn't worth it to go on. Our queen and our government fled to England, and we started 5 long years of Nazi occupation. Actually, we were annexed to Germany. We were part of Germany, the Third Reich. After the, just before the Dutch army capitulated, the Nazis bombed the city of Rotterdam. So here you have an ironic story. They want the harbor, but then they bomb it. With a threat, the next day they would bomb The Hague, the seat of our government, and the following day they would bomb Amsterdam, our capital. That's why we capitulated. As soon as the Nazis came in, everything for every Dutch person changed. First of all, they needed to have housing for the occupying Nazis, and we didn't have hotels in every street corner. So Nazis used to walk around in streets and areas where they were stationed. If they saw a nice house, they would kick the door open, or if they were polite, they would knock on the door, and they would want to see people's houses. And they would confiscate the house if they liked it. If they were nice, they would give the family that lived there maybe 1 or 2 rooms and the use of the kitchen and the bathroom. If they were not nice, they would say, well, you can live in a basement. In Holland, we don't have finished basements like you have here. So that was really, it made the Dutch people really angry. And then the other thing, when the Nazis came into Holland and they saw our stores with an overabundance of wonderful food, butter and eggs and you name it, meat. And the clothing stores were full, there was fabric galore, and they had nothing in Holland. So it was a wonderful thing. They just raided the stores and sent as much as they could to Germany. To make it fair, so the Dutch people wouldn't all starve, they instigated ration cards. So everything that you bought in the store, clothing, shoes, food, was rationed. And every month you had to go and get a new ration card. And the rations were meager. You had to still pay for stuff, but if you wanted a pound of sugar, you could get 1 pound of sugar a month. And at that time, people baked everything at home. We didn't have bakeries like we have today. So if you wanted to bake a cake because you had a birthday in the beginning of the month, but then you had another birthday at the end of the month, forget it. You couldn't bake a cake because you didn't have the ingredients unless you traded with somebody else or bought on the black market. So you can imagine Dutch people weren't very happy. The rules and regulations against Jews were unbelievable. If you owned a business, a profitable business, it was confiscated. So you weren't just fired, your business was taken away from you. And that happened to my dad and his father, who had together a textile business. They manufactured and they had a chain of stores where they sold what they made. So forget it, no more work, no more salary or income. I forgot to say that my father was taken prisoner of war, but when Holland capitulated, a couple of weeks after that, they let all the prisoners of war go back to their country. They needed the barracks in Germany for other people, and they thought that the army is not organized anymore anyway, so they let people go back, and that's when my father came home. So here his business is taken away. Then he could not take, or no Jew could take, public transportation. The bicycles were confiscated. And then you got orders on a certain day that you had to bring in all your valuables. If you had stocks or bonds or savings books, jewelry, gold, silver, radio, camera, whatever was of value, you could not own. And you had to bring it to a collection point. When you brought your stuff in, you got a receipt, and you were told that you would get your stuff back. This was just for safekeeping. Well, I'm here to tell you that the stuff that you handed in never stayed in Holland. It went straight to Germany, and nobody ever got anything back. What they would give you is an equivalent of $50, because you still had to eat. Well, you can imagine if the war would have lasted a week, maybe that would have worked. But the war lasted 5 years, so $50 really didn't feed a family. If you, Jewish children were not allowed to be educated in public schools, public universities, and they could only be educated by Jewish teachers. Now, I was born in the town of Haarlem. If you look again at the map, you see that pink indicator. And that's indicating to Amsterdam, our capital. And then you go a little bit more to the west, you end up in the Atlantic Ocean. Between the Atlantic Ocean and Amsterdam is the town of Haarlem. It's a good-sized town, not as big as Amsterdam. And we had a fairly large Jewish community. Amsterdam had the largest Jewish community in Holland. And so Amsterdam and Haarlem had Jewish schools. But in the country, sometimes there were two, three families, Jewish families, and they had to homeschool their children. If you were sick, only a Jewish doctor could come to you and try to make you better. Or you could only go to a Jewish dentist. And so I want to explain that we had four different groups in Holland. The first group was a persecuted group. They were Jews, Gypsies, homosexuals, communists, Poles, Jehovah's Witnesses, mentally and physically handicapped people. In Holland, that was all over. Those were the hated, persecuted groups by the Nazis. In Holland, the largest group were Jews. Most of the other people, we had some Gypsy camps, but other people, it wasn't so obvious. Then we had the collaborators, and those were the people that loved the Nazi occupation and tried anything they could to help them and to work against all the Dutch people. Those were the hated people, but those people really got away with a lot of things. They helped the Nazis, they denounced people that helped Jews, they denounced Jews, they found Jews. It was really a bad group of people. Then you have the group that I call a gray group, because those were the what they called bystanders. Those are people that seemed indifferent and didn't help groups that were persecuted, but it didn't really betray people either and didn't denounce people. They just didn't do anything. It's hard to judge that group, because you really had to live in that time to be able to say something about it. I'll go back to that group, but then the fourth group were what I called our heroes. Those were the people that completely defied all the Nazi rules and said, people in need that need help, we help them. And they organized, and we called them the underground. They were against the Nazi occupation. Tried anything they could. Of course, they were denounced often by the collaborators. But they were really heroes, not just because of what they did, but by what they were doing, they were risking their life. Sometimes they risked the life of their spouses and their children. So for the gray group, if you are a family and you have young children, you want to keep those children safe. So for them not to have done anything, but just thinking about their children, I don't think they should be judged. Some people do, but I can't. I lived in that time, but I didn't have a family. Those were the groups, and I say heroes, because without those heroes, I wouldn't be standing here today. My parents could never have saved us alone. They needed help. I'll get back to about that. So we lived in the town of Haarlem, and my father, who had no job, his job was taken away, found a temporary job at a Jewish a dry cleaning place as a pants presser. And he had to walk about 4.5 miles in the morning because he had no bicycle and he couldn't take public transportation. And he had to walk back after 10 hours on his feet pressing pants. And he said he was a happy man doing that because he got paid every week so he could buy milk and bread and feed his family. He said you can do anything in those circumstances. Most important is that you take care of your family. Every day was a threatening day, and every day my parents were really afraid. But things kind of, they didn't know what was going to happen. Excuse me. So they kind of lived day by day. We befriended the family across the street from us. It was a very large, very orthodox, very religious Jewish family. Large family, father and mother, 7 unmarried children, all my parents' ages, around 30. And the father's parents lived with them, and 2 unmarried aunts. Really large family. They were still keeping the traditions of the Jewish religion. And one of our traditions is that you have this wonderful holiday that comes back every week. It starts at sundown on Friday. So in that time, so in 1942 and in earlier, the tradition was that the men would go to services at the synagogue, and when they came back home, they would find a nice set table with all kinds of favorite foods, and the whole family nicely dressed, and people would sit around the table and eat. They would pray, they would sing songs, they would tell what they did that week, and it was just, it's a very nice gathering, and then you can go to bed, and you're free on Saturday, and the holiday's over at sundown on a Saturday. It's called Shabbat. And when we had our children, we lived in various places, and we always celebrated that, and the children still remember, because they do with their families too. It's a wonderful holiday. So I told you my parents weren't very religious, but the family across the street, knowing that we lived across the street from them, my family was always invited and really loved it. The husband, the father of the large family, was the president of the Jewish community in Haarlem. Most of the family was not able to work because they'd lost their jobs because they were Jews. And one daughter who was a teacher lost her job, and so she became very good friends with my mom and helped my mom take care of her 2 little children. So when I was about 6 months old, our life changed. It became more threatening. The rules that I'm talking about are just for Holland. In Poland or in France or in other countries, the rules were a little bit different. They were similar, but sometimes it was a little different. So in Holland, Jews above the age of 6 had to wear a bright yellow star with the word Jew, for us written in Dutch, Jood, in the middle of it, on all their outer garments. If you left your house, you had to wear that star. So I made a exact copy of my dad's star, and that's also the color was exact copy that he had. And I'll put it on, but I don't do gladly, because it gives me a very creepy feeling. But I put it on because I want you to see what that looked like. I'm wearing a scarf, I have rings, I have a bracelet. So what really is a star? A star could be like a brooch. But look at this. Okay, I'll turn a little bit so you can all see it. I'm now branded different. When I started, I'm the same as you all are, right? I'm a person, but now I'm different. And I really dislike it, so I'll take it off. So people ask, why did you even wear it? Just go outside and not wear it. I didn't wear one because I was too young. Neither did my brother, but my parents wore a star. The problem in that time was that you didn't know who you could trust. Your friendly neighbor that you said good morning to every morning could turn against you and become a collaborator. And there was an incentive for people to become collaborators, because if they saw my parents walk around without a star, they could go to Nazi headquarters or Gestapo headquarters, and they could say, I have a Jew living next door, and they walked outside without a star. And that the Nazis would give them $20 or $25, whatever it was. And then they would go over, and they could make really bad things happen to the Jewish person who hadn't worn a star. They could kick you, beat you, kill you, throw you in jail. And when the deportations started in 1942, they could send you on an early train to a death camp in Poland. So you just didn't dare not wear a star. And with everything you did as a Jewish person, you always had to look behind you because you didn't know who you could trust. You didn't know what they would do. Jewish children wearing a star, other kids could spit in their faces. They could stick their foot out and make them trip. And you had nothing to say. Actually, the people that did bad things would be celebrated by the Nazis. And you had no place to complain to. It was really a very difficult life. The underground, the heroes, had gotten so organized around that time, same time, that to try to prevent the Nazis from finding where Jews lived, they blew up or set on fire different registration offices to make it hard for the Nazis to find Jews. And when they did it in the town of Haarlem, the next morning the Nazis were so angry that they took the 10 most prominent Jewish men, marched them onto the main square of Haarlem, just in the time that mothers were doing their meager shopping with their children, and in front of the population they shot and killed these 10 men. So it was the father across the street who was the president of the community, the two rabbis, the two cantors, and five other men that were killed. So that was the next shock. We also got orders to move to Amsterdam because the Nazis were trying to concentrate all Jews. The trains were ready, and they didn't want to have to go in the country and find Jewish families. So we didn't move right away when we got the orders because we didn't really have a place to live. A couple of days after the man across the street was shot, a large truck stopped in front of their house. The one daughter that was a really good friend of my mom's, her name was Selma, and she saw it. She was in our house, and she saw her whole family being rounded up and pushed onto the truck. And there were a couple of cousins in her house, too. So the truck drove away, and besides one brother who later escaped, she never saw her family again. That same night, we moved to Amsterdam. My father was afraid that the next truck would come for us. So we moved, my father and my mother and my brother and myself and our friend Selma, who stayed with us during the whole time that we were in hiding. My father didn't have a good hiding place, so one of his military friends that he had been prisoner of war with, that helped us a lot, he's part of the underground, just said, you come and stay with us, so you can make anything work. It's a very small apartment, and we all just cramped in, and my father went out to look for a good hiding place. He found an attic, a storage attic, in an Amsterdam, on top of an Amsterdam, a set of row houses. And it was a real storage area with dusty suitcases and boxes. But it had some furniture. It had a table and chairs. It had a cupboard and probably some utensils. When you go into hiding, you don't exist anymore. We had fake identity papers. Told you my name was Maria. Maria was written on my mom's identity papers. And nobody is really supposed to know where you are, because if they know where you are, you're not in hiding anymore. So not being able to take a moving truck with all the stuff, they just figured the bare minimum they needed. They brought mattresses for the adults and my brother, and a crib for me since I was only 6 months old. The hiding place, or the attic, was one area, and it had a small toilet and a small sink with cold running water. It did not have a bathroom with shower or bathtub, and it didn't have a kitchen. When my father was, when his business was taken away, he had asked some of the people that had worked with him if they would take out some of the bolts of fabric that they had used in the factory. And he figured, I'm going to need an income somehow. I need to barter. So a couple of yards of fabric, maybe we'll buy half a loaf of bread or something like that. But he also used some of the fabric to make rooms in the attic. So he hanged the fabric from the ceiling to the floor, and he made a room for himself and my mom and for Selma, and my brother and I shared a room. And then we had a living space with a dormer window. That was the only room that had a window. So it was a very dark attic, but we did have that one window. If there was anything to cook or if there was water to boil, then my mom used that camping stove. And she had oil for the camping stove that they brought in also, and oil for oil lamps, just in case the electricity would go off. Really old-fashioned kind of living. The attic was across the street from a park, what was really strategic, because my father knew that he would be the one to get out at night, or somebody from the underground would have to come and visit us if he didn't go out, because we needed food or medicine or whatever else we needed. And not having neighbors across the street, nobody would see this strange man all of a sudden appear at night. Where did he come from? He didn't exist anymore. So that was a safe thing. And the walk up, four steep flights of stairs, had its own entrance. It had its own front door, and then you had four flights of stairs going straight to the attic. All the other floors had their own entrance and their own stairs. So that was really very helpful for us. I have a picture that I took a few years ago, so it's a contemporary picture. There are colorful cars on the bottom, on the road, but we didn't have that. The only people that drove around in cars were Nazis or sometimes collaborators, and the Wehrmacht, the army, the German army. All other cars that had been in Holland were confiscated from everybody and sent on to Germany. So let me show you this picture. You see again that pink indicator, it indicates to the top, the white part, and you can see things sticking out. Those are the dormer windows. So it's quite high, and then you have to picture the main park in Holland, in Amsterdam, the Vondelpark, right across from that building. So my parents, just before we went into the attic, told my two-year-old brother, it's your responsibility to take care of your sister. Whatever happens, you can never leave her. You guys need to stay together. Of course, they were hoping and dreaming that if we were ever separated for some reason, that the children would have each other. They were very lucky, because who would have known? Nobody knew what could happen. But my brother took it very seriously. And the moment I started walking, what was about 5 months after we went into hiding, he always wanted to hold my hand. And wherever we went, even to the bathroom, when we went to sleep, I had to put my arm through the slats of my crib and he would hold my hand. And then, of course, you fall asleep and you relax. And next morning, where is she? Grab my hand again. And sometimes when I got a little bit older, it really irked me. I didn't like it, but I had nothing to say. That's the way it was. And he took care of me. He had one toy that he was allowed to bring into hiding, and it was a little wooden pull horse, like a wooden horse on four wheels. And he used to walk with me on one hand and then a pull horse on the other hand, and I was allowed to look at it, but not to play with it. That was his toy. So you can imagine what I thought at that time. I think that our attic was small when I think about it now. But for a little child that starts walking, it was huge. So we did have quite a lot to walk. People always ask, what happened to your neighbors below? Because you can see their apartments below that, you know, three sets underneath the attic. We didn't know them, and they didn't know us. So you can say, well, they maybe belong in that gray area. Maybe they were just bystanders. They didn't want to help anybody. But in our case, that was perfect. Had they known us, they would have worried about us if they had been good Dutch people and not collaborators. And if they were ever asked by a Nazi or collaborator, do you have any idea if anybody lives up there in that attic? Not knowing us, they could say, no, there's nobody there, it's just dusty storage stuff. Had they known us, they might have worried and they might have given it away. So it was much better for us that help came from afar. Now you probably wonder, and what did you do in that attic every day? You know, without think about your children or think about yourself with your Xbox and your iPhone and your computer and your radio and your films and whatever, Netflix. We had nothing, not even newspapers. But we were kept busy. My father took a lot of paper, scrap paper, with him into hiding, and if he needed more, he used to ask his friends in the underground. And he took color pencils. And so I'm crawling around, we're just in the attic, and my brother is sitting with my parents and Selma around the table, and they're having a really good time, in my opinion. Mom and Selma are always sewing something because we're growing and we need clothes. So they were cutting up their own clothes or whatever they were doing, they were making stuff for us. But they were also, and my father too, doing things with my brother. And they had a really good time. So as soon as I started walking, and I was a really early talker, I wanted to sit with them. So since I was talking a lot, my father said, yeah, but you can just listen. You can sit with us, but just listen. Stop talking. Very hard for me. So I sat with them, and what were they doing? They were teaching my brother colors. They were doing all kinds of games with colors, numbers, letters, words. They were homeschooling him, and it kept him busy. So whatever we woke up, if there was anything to eat around breakfast time, we didn't even know about breakfast, then we would get that, or if there was absolutely nothing, my mom would boil water and we would get a cup of hot water, what kind of settles your stomach somewhat for a little bit. But we always had something, and then we would sit around the table and we would be homeschooled. So by the time we were liberated, I was 3 years old, and I could read and simple writing. My writing wasn't as good as my reading, and I could do simple arithmetic. And it's not because I'm so smart. That's all we did. And if you think about your own life, you learn something and then you go home and you have all these distractions. You have your friends, you have your parties, you have your sports, so the next morning you have to kind of review it again to remember what you just learned. For us, it was every day the same thing. And you learn that way, no outside distractions. My parents never talked about the outside world. That was really to protect their children. They never talked about their relatives. They were very worried about them, and our faces were always worried, but we didn't know the difference. And they never talked about the Nazis. They never talked about us being Jewish. They never talked about the weather. They just never talked about it. Our life was completely within those four walls and whatever happened in those four walls. And that was really to protect us. I always give the example, if my mom had seen beautiful sunlight through that dormer window, and she had said, it's a beautiful spring day, I wish I could take your children to the park and you could play outside, we would have questioned her. We would have asked, you know, what is a park, what's playing outside? And we would have missed it. We didn't miss it because they never told us. And the other thing, and I was just telling the school this morning, is that whatever the adults said, that was it. We didn't have a challenge. And if my parents had told me something and I'd gone to school and I would have told my best friend, my parents said that, whatever, this morning I gave an example of, that I should paint my hair green, and my friend would have said, are you crazy? You're just not going to do that. But if my parents had said something like that to me, okay. And the other example is that you can make a child believe anything. When my grandchildren were young and they were sitting in the back of the car and I was driving, they were fooling around in the back. And I used to say, stop it. And they said, why should we stop? I said, because I'm the law and you listen to me. That's how it was. And it was like that all my life. I've never said, while my parents were alive, I never said anything against them. Sometimes I thought, okay, I'm going home, I'm grown up, I'm not going to do that. But I would never say that to them. I kept that same respect. I just never learned how to do that. We were hungry, and we were cold in the winter. But we were used to it. We weren't used to three meals a day, and we knew, my brother and myself, that we would get something every day, even if we shared only half a cracker because there wasn't more. And then my parents and Selma, of course, went hungry. But we didn't ask anything, and we didn't tell them that we missed something because we didn't know about it. So it was a really smart strategy, and it really got us through, especially the children. But it was tough on my parents, who were always worried. I already mentioned that my parents always had a very worried look on their faces, but we didn't know any better. But then my father went out again in June 1944, and he came back, and my brother said to him, "Papa, what happened? You look different." So my father came home with the incredible news that the Allied army had landed in Normandy, northern France. So he actually explained to us, he said, our life between these four walls will probably be over soon. And whatever he said to the adults, but that's what he said to the children. We didn't really understand that, but my father looked happier, and also he wanted to celebrate that moment. He said that the Allied army has landed, we need to have a celebration. Well, a celebration today, of course, is really easy. If you forget your best friend's birthday and in the morning you wake up, you can still have a wonderful party at night because everything is right there. And of course, now you have your cell phone and you order everything and it's easy, not while you're in hiding. You have to really plan it. So my father asked his friend from the underground for ingredients to bake a birthday cake. And I don't know how he got it, I don't know how he paid for it, but he made a cake on top of a camping stove. I'm a pretty good baker, but I need an oven. I don't know how he did it. My mom cut up an old blouse and made a beautiful birthday dress for me, and Selma from Old Rags made a doll. That's gonna be my first doll. And my brother, good boy that he was, he wrapped his only toy, and he's gonna give it to me on my birthday. That's gonna be my present. My father's friends said that he would come over that same day. He had been over to our place before to see how we were doing, and he would take pictures of the birthday girl. Then he would, at the end, take the film and everything home with him. He couldn't leave anything because you never knew who would, you know, it could open a can of worms if you left things that Jews were not allowed to have. So for the picture, he brought me socks and shoes. The shoes are about two sizes too small, but he said she needs to be complete, her birthday dress, socks and shoes. I didn't have socks and shoes because my mom, of course, couldn't go out to a store to buy them if they were still there. So we had booties, my brother and I, when it was cold weather, that Mom and Selma made for us. And he also gave my father, this friend, gave my father a small wicker doll's chair, really small chair. And she said she'll get her first doll and she can play house. So I'm going to show you that picture because I'm standing here today. And but I want to tell you first that that picture is a tribute to my parents. You'll see a perfectly normal two-year-old sitting on a doll's chair. I look big, but I was really tiny because the chair was so tiny. But it's not any different than any of your children or your cousins or your little brothers and sisters. This is what a two-year-old should look like. The best present, of course, was my brother's pull horse. I like that better than the doll. But he told me that it was just for the day. I have to give it back at night. It was all right. It was all right. My brother still has it. It's like a trophy on a shelf. But, I mean, it was mine for one day, and I'll never let him forget it. So my dad was right. The army, as soon as they got organized, started liberating. They liberated the northern part of France and Paris. Then they liberated the western part of Belgium, and they came to Holland, I'll get you the map again. They came to Holland and liberated the southern part of Holland. And you see, if you look at the Netherlands, you see three blue lines horizontally. Those are the three big rivers that run into Rotterdam. That's why Rotterdam is such an important harbor city again. And that's the Rhine River, the Waal River, and the Lek River. So the Allies liberated the southern part of France, came to the rivers in September 1944, and then something strange happened. We had an early onset of one of the most severe winters in Northern Europe, and the rivers froze, and the Allies did not have the right equipment to cross the rivers. So they left the Canadian Army camped by the rivers, and they went on and liberated the eastern part of Belgium, and they went into Germany. With a lot of battles, they started liberating slowly parts of Germany. And you know the Battle of the Bulge was a very bloody battle. And so it wasn't as easy as I make it believe, but I can't go into details. I don't have the time for it. So we had 8 more months of horrible occupation and cold. Our winter crops were frozen. The Nazis closed all the supply lines. And we also lost our electricity, so we were hungry and we were cold. When the southern part of Holland was liberated, they had food again, because as soon as liberation starts, slowly food will reach the area again, maybe not overabundance, but a little bit at a time. And my father had asked some people from the underground that he worked with, if he could get a lot of flour, sugar, and butter. And with those ingredients, he baked cookies on top of the camping stove for almost a week. He asked people from the underground for empty tins. So he put the cookies in the tins and he sealed the tins, and that was our emergency food. And he called it my nutritious cookies because of all the butter that was in there. But there were plenty of days that we only shared half of a cookie, my brother and I. My parents tried to go without something long enough, and then they had half a cookie each. I mean, that was it. There was not more. One time, somebody from the underground brought over a bag of tulip bulbs and said, you know, you can make a delicious stew with that. So Mom and Selma did that, and it was just in a time that it was so cold. And so they made this tulip bulb stew, and they put it in bowls for us. And the start was wonderful. We put our hands around it and warmed our hands and our face over it, and the steam would warm our face. And then you eat it, your whole body warms up. Right. It stayed with us for about an hour because it's poison. And with lots of cramps, it left our body. And thank goodness that was all that was. But that was the end of the tulip bulb stew. We really couldn't eat it anymore. Lots of plane traffic, stray bombs falling off, Nazi planes trying to bomb England, flying over Holland, and then Allied planes flying over Holland, bombing cities in Germany. So we had lots of air raid alarms, and those were to warn people that they had to go into shelters. Mostly they were basements or cellars, so where were we going to go? We don't exist anymore. We couldn't all of a sudden. My parents and Selma appeared with 2 little kids. From where and who would betray us, right? So we sat on the staircase. The staircase is the strongest part of an Amsterdam row house. And that's where we stayed till another alarm would sound that the bomber had flown over. The last winter, we did a lot of crying, my brother and myself, because our hands and our feet hurt. We had chilblains, or we called it winter feet, winter hands. It was just unbearable, the pain. And okay, I'll share it with you. It's a yucky story, but my father knew that farmers had this problems with chilblains, and if they, especially in the wintertime, had to feed their livestock. So to alleviate the pain, the farmers used to put their feet or their hands in cow or horse urine. And the uric acid in the urine is the same thing that you can get in, that is in the creams that is supposed to treat chilblains. My father couldn't get medicine. So before we went to bed, my brother and I had to pee on a potty and put our hands and feet in that. And the pain would go away. We could go to sleep without pain. And again, my parents made us do that. There was nobody to tell us. It was yucky. So we just did it. I tell you now, you're probably all grossed out. But it helped us. And you do what you have to do. There's a lot of stuff that happened in those last 8 months, but I can't go into it all because then I speak until 7 o'clock, and I don't have that time today. So I'll tell you about liberation. Liberation for us came on May 5th, 1945. Lots of noise on the street. And my father, for the first time, opened that dormer window, and he looked out, and he looked back, and he said, "I think it's over. I think we're free." So they were, on one hand, sad because they didn't know what happened to their family yet. And on the other hand, the only thing they could think about is, oh, God, my children will have a life. So my father was quite hungry, and he ran to the cupboard, opened the last tin of cookies. Miraculously, we had one tin left. I don't know how that happened, but it's the truth. And he stuffed his face and told us all we could have as much as we wanted. Of course, our stomachs were so tiny that after one cookie, we weren't hungry anymore. But my brother said, wonderful, we're free. It means eating cookies. We had just no concept. So on that day, our parents explained to us that I wasn't Maria anymore, but I became Louisa again. And like I said, there's no challenge. What my parents said is the way it was. You just accept it. And then they waited a couple of days, and they said, we're going to take you outside. We're going to go to the park, and now you'll play outside. So when our door opened on top, and my brother and I holding on to each other, we followed my father 4 flights of stairs down, which was weird. But then I will never forget the feeling when he opened the front door. All that light, you know, the stairwell was dark. So here is all that light, and there are no more walls. And we really, my brother and I, are scared to death. So my parents took us by the hand, took us to the park, and my mom said again, you're free, now play outside, have fun. My brother and I are holding on for dear life, we're scared to death. I mimicked everything that my brother did. He started crying, I started crying. And my brother said, if this is what it means to be free, I don't want to be free. It was heartbreaking for my mom, and that was really the first time I saw my mom cry. They took us back upstairs, explained some more. My first meal was oatmeal that my mom had gotten for us. I never liked it, but I didn't dare say that to her. But they explained a lot more, and then a couple of days later, they said, we're going out for a walk. It was beautiful spring, it's May, and all the Canadian soldiers that had liberated Holland, a lot of them came to Amsterdam, and everybody walked around. All Dutch people did too. Finally, you can get out, the Nazis are gone, everybody in rags, nobody had beautiful clothes, holy clothes and too short clothes and whatever it was. And a lot of people did not have shoes, and neither did we. We had canvas booties that Mom and Selma made for us. These Canadian soldiers were super friendly. My brother and I are still holding on to each other for dear life, and we're still scared, but they gave us a good feeling. Children pick up on what people are like. They tried to talk to us, but we didn't speak English, so we couldn't understand what they were saying. But they pulled Hershey bars out of their pockets. And my mom said that we could take it, because you're not supposed to take from a stranger. That was the only time in my memory that we were allowed to take that. And you have no idea what a first bite of chocolate tastes like. I mean, you're used to it, but it was unbelievable. So, but we couldn't finish the whole bar, and we took the rest of it home. The next morning, something strange happened. My brother woke up, he jumped off his mattress, and he screamed, can we go outside again? My parents are just dumbfounded, you know, here they're scary kids, they don't want to do anything. He wanted more chocolate. So you can imagine, children are resilient. So you pick up on good things, and slowly, we really got back to being very normal children. My parents had decided never to talk about the war. They didn't want to have anything to do with religion because religion is dangerous. Well, it's a little strange when your last name is Israels. But they really felt very strongly about that. And we weren't allowed to ask questions because they just didn't want us to be worried. They never talked about the family that we had lost because only my father's parents survived. And they thought, well, they didn't know them anyway. They were so young that we don't talk about them and they won't miss them. Of course, we wanted to ask questions, especially me, but it just didn't work out because my father used to give me a look and then I knew I couldn't ask anymore. So I saved my questions for my time that I spent with my friend Selma, my mom's age, that I stayed friends with till she passed away about 9 years ago. And she was able to answer a lot of questions. She was careful not to step on my parents' toes, but she told me a lot of things. And when I was about 15, I decided that I wanted to be Jewish. So I contacted a rabbi. I said, I'm born Jewish, but I don't know anything about it, and my parents won't help. He said, but you need to talk to them. So I said, okay, but I didn't do it. I was afraid. Then at 16, I called the rabbi again. He said, did you talk to your parents? I said, all right, I'm 16. I'm going to try it. And I have to give my parents credit. They let me make up my own mind, but they didn't do a thing to help me, and I was very resentful. I totally understand it now. They brought us up, that's the one thing, with a lot of hatred towards Germans, the German language, the country, and German products. God forbid if my husband had had a Volkswagen and would have parked it in front of my father's house, my parents' house, I wouldn't be married over 50 years now because my father would have said he's no good. And that's how it was, and I probably would have believed him too. So when I was married, we were married and had our own family, I used that same hatred. It's a time of my life I'm not very proud of, because growing up, I should have realized that it was not right. But like I said, what my parents said, that's what I believed, and that's not right. I should have thought for myself. So when our middle daughter was 9 years old, she did something and she talked to people and they called me and I realized it wasn't her fault, it was my fault. We had to turn things around. You can't go through life with that kind of hatred. That's how the Holocaust started, with that little four-letter word, hate. So we were able to turn it around, and our children are really not biased towards anybody, and I try not to be either. Maybe Germany will never be my favorite country, but I don't blame the younger generation. They had nothing to do with it. It's not their fault. You can't blame other people or other younger generations for what their parents or grandparents did. So I'm kind of happy about that. During the war, during the Holocaust, approximately 12 million people were murdered by the Nazis. Out of the 12 million people, there were 6 million Jews. And out of those 6 million Jews, there are 1.5 million Jewish children, innocent children that had not done anything wrong. They never even had a chance, but they were born Jewish, and that's why they were murdered. So the Holocaust, and people let it happen. They didn't do anything. They didn't question it. They just let it happen. And when they tell you, we didn't know, I'm here to tell you that that was a lie. People knew what was going on. Maybe not in the beginning, but afterwards, they did know what was going on, and they didn't do anything about it. The Holocaust, of course, was genocide. People haven't learned in the world a thing, because genocide is still going on. Not too long after the Holocaust, in the mid-70s, or in the late-70s, was Cambodia. 1992 was Bosnia, 1994 was Rwanda. And then you had Sudan in Africa and other African countries, and look what is happening in the Middle East. People are being murdered because they're different, not because they've done anything wrong. And we just cannot continue that. Our museum, and I hope you will get that, I don't have that written down anywhere, I think. Maybe, I'm looking. Our website.
I think it's on the very front.
On the front?
Mm-hmm. I think so.
I looked. Yes, thank you. You see our website here. So on our website, you can get ideas what you can do against genocide and how you can help. you find a lot of stories and you find a lot of different ideas on this website. It's really very comprehensive and it's pretty amazing. So I want to read something to you as a last thing about people that so-called didn't know. Here is a saying from a pastor, Niemöller, who was at one time, he's a Lutheran pastor, and he, at one time he was a Nazi, and then he decided that wasn't right. So he came up with this quote, and I will read it to you, and I will also, I think it's here somewhere. It's not on here.
Keep going?
Yep. Thank you. So it says, first they came for the socialists, and I did not speak out because I was not a socialist. Then they came for the trade unionists, and I did not speak out because I wasn't a trade unionist. Then they came for the Jews, and I did not speak out because I wasn't a Jew. And then they came for me, and there was no one left to speak for me. So with that, I would like to open it up for questions. And thank you very much for being such attentive listeners. Okay, we have a mic.
Do you have another microphone?
Unless you want to really speak up, or I can repeat a question. Anybody with a question? You know, I only touched on a very small part. Yes, sir.
Obviously, it started, you were just born. What is your frame point of memory from when you were too young versus what are your earliest memories of any of this happening?
Some flashes from really early life, like walking with bare feet on mats made out of coconut fibers, and that was painful. So if I walk on something that is harsh, I remember that. But especially from my second birthday on, because there was such a change. And I am blessed, or I sometimes say cursed, with a photographic memory. So I can have a film go off in my mind, and that's why I can say that. Whatever I told you, that's what really happened. I did verify later on with my friend Selma, and then just before my father died, he couldn't stop talking about it, so we talked about a lot of things. But most of it is from my second birthday on is memory.
Thank you.
Yes. Yes, ma'am.
No transportation at all. How did you move to Amsterdam?
You see, I think that they took a taxi. But I talked to my brother about it, and he doesn't exactly, he said, I think we were in a car, but there's nobody left to ask. So I think that's what they did. And there were taxis at that time. Not many, and not fancy yellow taxis or anything. They're just old cars that people had. And I think that's what they used. Because I've asked that many times, and there's certain things, there's just nobody left to ask. Yes. Well, the question was how long I stayed in the Netherlands. My parents, a couple of months after we were liberated, my mom rented a room in the country so her children, my brother and myself, could be outside. She wanted fresh air for us. And then a Swedish friend, Sweden had been neutral during the Second World War, and a Swedish friend of my dad's came in September 1945 to see if he could help or if we were still alive, and offered my dad a job. So we moved for 2 years to Sweden. And then in 1948, we came back because the Dutch government needed to get the economy growing again. And they had just figured out what Jewish family had survived and if there were Jewish businesses. And none of the Dutch businesses were up and running. Everything was stolen and sent to Germany. So the economy was flat. So they asked my dad to come back to Holland and see if he could restart his business. And he did that with the help of the Marshall Plan. I did all my schooling in Holland, except for the 2 years in Sweden. And I became a physical therapist and worked for a large practice in Amsterdam, where I met my husband, who was an American medical student in Amsterdam. So when he was finished 3 years later with his studies, we were married and we had a little child, and we came in 67, and has nothing to do with the Holocaust. We really stayed in Holland.
You referenced your friend Selma, and earlier you said that she watched her family be taken away, but she was able to reunite with one brother, I believe.
Yes.
How did that happen?
He escaped. And I don't really know from where. It could have been the transient camp that we had in Holland, Westerbork, or he escaped. Some people jumped from the train. Some of were lucky and some were instantly killed. He escaped and then went into hiding. And after the war, they found each other. Also, she was engaged before the war, and her fiancé was hidden in the southern part of Holland. So as soon as the northern part was liberated, he walked for days, and they found each other and got married. Yeah. She never wanted to stay in Holland. She didn't trust anybody. She wanted to go to Israel when it was proclaimed a state in 1948. Her husband didn't want to. So when she was 80, her husband passed away, and she still moved to Israel, where she had very happy 11 years. We had contact. I used to visit her every other year, and we spoke to each other every week. Very exceptional lady. Yes.
Did your family, did your parents know the Frank family?
I can't tell you. I don't know. I don't know. Yep.
How did you actually have your ceremony to become Jewish?
Oh, there was no ceremony. Girls were not bat mitzvot. That didn't exist in the time that I grew up. So since I was born Jewish, it was no problem. I just took lessons from the rabbi because I wanted to know. I was a very inquisitive child. And that was it. And then, of course, my big luck happened that my husband is Jewish. So we got married in Amsterdam, and there's no problem. Yes.
Did your friend Selma ever talk about if, like, there was any action outside of the home? Like, were you guys, were your parents or Selma ever able to see if, you know, German troops were still, you know, hounding, you know, raiding apartments or whatever? Like, were
they
in constant fear like that, that they would eventually be caught?
They knew that because my father, when he went out, brought home news. But they never talked to us about it. But they were, all the years that they were in hiding, they were always in fear, but they didn't want us to know what was going on. Yes?
Question, have you ever written your story?
No, I haven't written my story, but I have written stories. And that was a request of my granddaughter. When I talked about it, she said, why don't you write it down? And I said, I can do a lot of things, so writing is really not my thing. So the Holocaust Museum offered and still offers a writing workshop. So I participate with that, and I've written some stories, and some of them the Holocaust Museum has published. When you get onto our website, you Google my name, you can find out some of my podcasts, some talks, and also some of the stories I've written. But a lot of them I don't want to publish because they're very private, they're for my children. But I can't write a book. I don't know how to write. That's not my thing.
What happened to collaborators?
Okay, that's a kind of a funny, not so funny story. Everybody knew who was a collaborator, especially in small towns. So they took them from their houses, just Dutch people, shaved their hair, their heads, and then they paraded them on horse-drawn carriages, and the whole population was allowed to throw at them what they wanted, rotten tomatoes, eggs, whatever. But, you know, it was mostly rotten stuff because food was so little that you didn't. But whatever you had, you could throw at them, and you were not going to be sent to jail. They got what they deserved. But all their lives, people knew exactly who they were. So if you were a collaborator dentist, people wouldn't go to you. Maybe another collaborator would go, but if you were a collaborator, had a grocery store, people wouldn't buy from you. So their life wasn't very pleasant. The only unpleasant thing that happened, that children of collaborators were also really badly treated. And like I said before, it's not their fault. They didn't make those decisions, it was their parents. This is only Holland. Different countries have different ways of treating people.
What happened to children of Nazis? How were they treated?
If a girl or a young woman went out with an occupying Nazi, they were also shaven and they were made fun of, and a lot of them left the country and in the late 40s immigrated because their life in Holland was not fun. And if they had children, those children were badly treated too. And there were a good amount of young Dutch women that went with Germans, soldiers or Nazis. Some of them did it so they would get better food and they could feed their families. Some of them, it wasn't only selfish, because food was so scarce for everybody. So if you could get an extra loaf of bread by going with a Nazi, they did it, and it would feed a family for a long time. So there, again, it's a gray area. If you just did it out of selfish reasons, that's one thing. But some of them did it and had a good reason.
Did Amsterdam and the hometown avoid a lot of the destruction?
Because we capitulated, they didn't really destroy anything in Amsterdam.
But even after that, on both sides, it was never...
There were stray bombs. Like I mentioned that the staircase was the strongest part of an Amsterdam row house. I'm not sure if you're on top of the staircase and they had hit your house, you would have had a roof on your head. So I'm not sure that you would have survived. But walking around in Amsterdam, we saw some houses where just the staircase was still standing. But really, just destroying the city, they didn't do. We were part of Germany, so they weren't really destroying their own country.
Thank you for coming here and telling your story. I'm thinking about the current political situation in the United States and one of the candidates who's bringing out awful hatred of people.
We call that a bully. And Hitler, in my opinion, was the biggest bully that ever walked the earth. And if you were a children's in a school group, I would give my speech about a bully. I can't be political because the museum would not allow me. I can have my private thoughts, but I cannot really talk to you about that. But I warn children to stand up to a bully. And what is a scary, very scary thing, because a bully doesn't want you to stand up to him, so you need to ask for help. And to children, I say, go in your school and look at your teachers and your principal, and at home, look at your parents or your grandparents, or call the police. When you see that somebody is doing something that you know is not right, you need to stand up. And then you find out how many other people were actually afraid and would love to join you and stand up, and the bully will never have a chance. Who knows what's going to happen here? Yes.
I know I already asked a question, but I'm going to ask again. Do you know how your father found that attic?
My father, his business was in Amsterdam. He had studied in Amsterdam, and he had a lot of friends in Amsterdam. So he found it by talking to people. He also paid rent for 10 years. He still had money at that time, a little bit of savings, and he figured going out every month and having to pay a landlord, what if he can't get out? And the landlord comes and throws everybody on the street. So he paid for 10 years, but we were lucky it was only three. You have a question?
I do.
Okay.
Do you have any idea of how many families were in situations like yours? Was there any sort of connection between families that survived?
No. Maybe much later. I went to a synagogue with a lot of child survivors in Amsterdam a couple of years ago, and people actually talked. But when I grew up, nobody talked. It was all in Holland. It was like, pull up your sleeves and rebuild the country, and it's over. We don't talk about it. Dutch people didn't want to talk about it. Jewish people didn't want to talk about it. Nobody did. So I, no, nobody talked.
Children are noisy. How did your parents keep you quiet so that the neighbors didn't hear that you were up there?
I'm sure the neighbors heard us, but like I said, they must have been good neighbors. They didn't care, and they didn't want to know, because then they could give us away. It's a different situation with the Anne Frank family, who was five blocks away from us in the middle of Amsterdam. They were hidden above Mr. Frank's business. So there were some collaborators working in his business. So they had to be quiet all day long until Mr. Frank's secretary gave him a sign when everybody was gone, and then they could finally walk around. Somebody walked around too early, and that's why they were denounced and deported. And except for Mr. Frank, everybody was killed. But in our case, a child mimics everything. If you see somebody else run, then you run. But I don't remember seeing that, so we walked. We never talked with a loud voice, because we never heard my parents talk with a loud voice. So you mimic what you see. But I am sure we flushed the toilet. I'm sure that our neighbors below us actually heard what was going on, but they just never denounced us. We were lucky. Thank you very much for being so attentive. Really great people.